Our next speaker is Dr. Thomas McLean. He's a senior executive officer with the Innovative Vector Control Consortium. He's been working in this area of trying to optimize the utility of our current tools, specifically in this case, insecticides, for applications to control of these diseases. And you'll hear from him some very exciting concepts about how we are attempting to maximize what we currently have while at the same time trying to make efforts for discovering new products. Dr. McLean, please.
Thank you for the opportunity to come and talk here today. I'm going to be really moving right down the spectrum away from the kind of things that David was talking about. He was talking about the very beginning of the discovery process and trying to understand where the new opportunities are for new interventions in disease control. And I'm going to take us right the way to the other end of the spectrum and talk about when you've discovered those things, how do you bring them out of the laboratory and get them into the field and get them actually used by people? So, thanks to the previous two speakers who've given us a beautiful introduction to malaria and the role of the vector in malaria transmission. But I think one of the things that we need to pick out from our understanding of that is that vector control has been a cornerstone of the historic successful attempts at malaria control. And before we depress ourselves too badly about how depressing malaria is today, we should remember that malaria has been driven out of large parts of the world, including from here in America. And the question for us now is, how do we push it further? How do we go that extra mile to move it, instead of out of these relatively easy to work in parts of the USA and in Europe, into these much more difficult parts of the world to work in sub-Saharan Africa, in Southeast Asia, and in America? When I say difficult to work in, I don't mean that there are problems with working with the people there. They're all fine to work with. It's the whole environment that you need to work in. We're working in places where this is the kind of conditions that people live in. That if you live in sub-Saharan Africa, you probably live in a house that looks like this. And in that house, when you go in there at night to sleep, you know how annoying it is when there's a mosquito in the room with you? In a place like this, there are probably 40 or 50 mosquitoes. And they are there explicitly to bite you. The only reason they come in the house is because they want to bite you. So how are we going to do vector control in a place like this? Now, you already know of many of the techniques for vector control. We talk about spraying, we talk about nets, but often we don't have an image of what spraying looks like. We think of spraying with insecticide. Maybe it's like somebody goes in with a can of Raid and sprays it around a bit. It's not like that at all. Indoor residual spraying looks like this. A guy turns up with a big suit and a face mask and big black gloves, says, "It's all going to be perfectly safe. I want you to take all of your furniture out of the house, and we're going to spray it like this." And he has to come four times a year to do this and completely disrupt your life, make life very uncomfortable. If you didn't want to have your house sprayed, perhaps we could have a net instead. We all know of the great successes of the net campaigns that have been running over the last few years. They are indeed very effective. The problem is that sleeping under a net is extremely uncomfortable. It's much too hot in those places already. You don't need your life made any more uncomfortable by sleeping under a hot, stuffy net. The other challenge that we have with the bed nets is that if you're going to put this anywhere near a child, the first thing you have to assume is that child is going to suck it, and they do. So if you're going to make an insecticide-treated bed nets, you'd better make it with something that you are prepared to feed to your children. And that kind of limits the range of things we can look at. But that's okay. So far, we have two effective interventions for vector control. Only two. What happens if in those two effective inventions for vector control, the mosquitoes stop dying? And this is a piece of data from a much studied island, or Bioko is just off the coast of Equatorial Guinea here. And in 2004, they were monitoring their spray campaign, and they sprayed with pyrethroid insecticide, one of the very safe, very common agricultural insecticides. And they were tracking two populations of mosquitoes. The green is Anopheles fenestus, and the blue is the Gambiae. The fenestus died, which shows us that the spraying was being done right, but the Gambiae didn't, because those mosquitoes are resistant to pyrethroid insecticide. They survived perfectly happily. Malaria transmission occurred all the way through that season. They had no impact at all with their disease control. They lost the whole year. Next year, they changed to carbamate, a much more expensive much less attractive insecticide, but the Gambii died. Now, the interesting thing is that they didn't need to lose that year. If they'd had the right information to start with about what their mosquito population was like, they could have sprayed carbamate or one of a number of other things at this point and saved that whole year of intervention. And we may ask, well, maybe if we have the right information, we can just go on switching insecticides to get away from these issues of resistance in the mosquitoes. The problem is that we only have four classes of insecticide that are suitable for use for vector control. These are the pyrethroids that I've just talked about, very safe, very attractive set. We have DDT, very effective, but politically very controversial. The carbamates and the organophosphates, both of which are effective, but which have quite serious toxicology issues associated with them. They're only just about safe enough for use in this area. And every one of these classes of insecticides has known and growing populations of resistant mosquitoes to them. So if we carry on as we are going to hit a stage, and it's well understood from the growth of insecticide resistance in the agricultural industry that this is coming to us. It's not a question of whether it happens, it's only a question of how long it happens when these tools in our armory don't work anymore. What's worse is that for the nets, we only have one insecticide that works, one class, that's the pyrethroids. All of these other things are too dangerous to put on a net. You could not conceive of putting that somewhere where a baby could suck it. And there is pyrethroid resistance out there, and there is the certainty that sooner or later, it's a time question, not an if question, that the pyrethroid-coated nets are going to stop working if we don't do something about it. So we're in a kind of a tight squeeze at the moment. We're in a situation where we only have two big interventions. Both of those look as though they're under threat from resistance. And when you start to try and map out what this resistance looks like, you start to see maps like this. Big clusters of resistance for a number of the different insecticide groups here, 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 and here. Interestingly, you start to see areas where you don't see indications of resistance. What's that about? Actually, that's got nothing to do with resistance, because over these large chunks of sub-Saharan Africa, there's nobody looking. This isn't a map of resistance. This is a map of people who are capable of detecting resistance. So the problem that we have is that it's too difficult at the moment to do a good job of detecting resistance. If we look back over the history of the development of a number of these products, what we see is that the insecticides that we use in public health have been coming out over the last 15 or 20 years from the pyrethroids, the latest set, then back earlier, the carbamates and the organophosphates in the 60s and 70s, back to the 1940s and with DDT and the early organophosphates. And at that point, we saw the emergence of the Hudson sprayer, that big tin can that the guy was holding as the prevalent intervention paradigm. And in the 1980s, the evolution of insecticide-treated nets when the pyrethroids came. And we start to see that the active ingredient and the way in which it's used are linked. And that if you look at the development cycle of these things, that the new products that come from the insecticide industry create new target product profiles, they create new intervention paradigms, and you get a virtuous circle that creates new ways of intervening with things. So what we need in order to address these problems we have now is new active ingredients to overcome the resistance problems. We need longer lasting formulations so that the scary guy in the blue suit doesn't have to come into your house four times a year. We need better information systems and tools so that we know that we are spraying the right thing in the right place. And we need completely new ways of delivering these. At the moment, we've only got the two paradigms that work. So why isn't the industry just doing this all for itself? Well, the central problem is that the marketplace is too small. There just isn't enough money in selling insecticides into vector control to pay for the $150 to $200 million that it costs to develop a new insecticide. We can't rely on the agricultural market to do it anymore because agricultural insecticide specifications have diverged right away from what you need for public health. A perfect agricultural insecticide consists of a systemic product that goes into the plant. It only kills the bugs that actually eat the plant, and it's fragile. What they really want is to get away from DDT. They don't want persistent insecticides. So what they make is products that disappear in a few days. And finally, the vector control community skills base really was severely damaged by the failure of the eradication campaigns of the 50s and 60s. And there really are not enough skilled people around to deliver many of these things anymore. But within all of the scary news, there is some new hope and some new opportunities. The first is what I describe here as the brave new world of the donor-funded product development partnerships. These are a group of not-for-profit organizations dealing with everything from vector control, drugs, vaccines, in every neglected disease you can imagine, who are bringing new economic processes to bear on the development of new products. And the second is that we have a battery of wonderful new technologies that have emerged since the 60s that we can apply to this. So to describe how we actually do this, we are a product development partnership. We are using funds from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, for which we are extremely grateful. We couldn't possibly do any of this without their support, and the foundation has really been an innovator and a driver of this approach to developing the products for disease control. And we work as a consortium with a number of industrial partners. And what we do is to put the money up front to take out the risk of the development cost to the company so that they can overcome that initial barrier and then take the product into market. What we get in return for putting that money up is a commitment from the companies that they will bring those products into the marketplace at an affordable price in the disease endemic countries, in a format that can be used in those countries, and at an appropriate volume. So they're making substantial long-term commitments about how they're going to deal with these products. We operate it in two groups. So we're bringing forward a set of insecticide products that we run in a conventional company portfolio scheme. You have to run those products very separately because they're with companies and there are intellectual property issues and eventually business issues associated with those products. But you'll recall that I was saying that we also need information systems and tools, and we run those projects as a consortium in which there's a great deal of overlap in the work between the consortium. We swap people between the different consortium groups. We're sharing data between the groups. We're sharing results. This is a consortium in the true sense of the word, that they share a common fate. They all stand or fall together. So looking at the overall portfolio for what the IVCC is trying to develop, I talked about new actives, and I'll come on to talk about the pipeline for those in a minute. We're looking at reformulation and repurposing to try and bring the last few remaining opportunities out of the agricultural industry to service. And then later I'll talk about information system tools and finally new paradigms. And so this is the pipeline for new formulations for long-lasting sprays. And you can see that we really have a significant number of projects now running in this. The ones with green dots are the projects that are actually running. Red dots mean we're in the process of finalizing the contract. Yellow means we've got a proposal on the table, and blue is an open opportunity where we're still looking for projects to come in. And you can see that the most advanced of our projects now are probably something like 18 months to 2 years away from actually arriving in the marketplace. Comparing that with the status that where we are with NETS, you see that life is much more difficult. A much leaner pipeline here. We have one starting at its very early stage, the proposal we have on the table at the moment. We have a bi-treated net product that's in the contract stage, but really nothing that's coming through in the same way, and that's because there is this great dearth of active ingredients that have the safety profile that would be acceptable for putting onto nets. So we're going right back to this whole issue of developing whole new active ingredients, and it's a long process. Going all the way from looking at the primary screening of new chemicals, all the way through optimization, the development, and in particular the toxicology testing of new products, and the registration and scale-up, it's a minimum 10-year program. But what we're finding is that there are a terrific range of opportunities. And the reason for that is that if you talk to the agricultural insecticide companies and say to the guys in the labs, have you got things that you know work for mosquitoes, but that you discarded for other reasons, mostly because they didn't have a broad enough range in, say, aphids or cotton boll weevil or those kinds of things. They say, yes, we know it's there. And there's a tremendous enthusiasm in that industry for those guys to go back and look at it, if only we can make it financially viable for them. Moving on now to talk about the information systems and tools and the new paradigms, I've tried to summarize it all in one view here because there are actually a whole series of projects going on here, but they're linked and dependent on each other. The first is setting up better ways of collecting entomological data so that we have teams based around sentinel sites who are collecting entomological abundance data, feeding it back into databases, and here I completely concur with David's remark that this kind of data doesn't count unless it's in big databases and unless it's publicly accessible. We're taking those entomological samples back into the lab for DNA, and instead of the very difficult bioassays that used to be done in the past, we're now looking at the DNA of the mosquitoes from which we can tell things like the species, its infection status, we can tell whether the mosquito itself was infected with Plasmodium, and its resistance status. So hopefully the map that I showed you earlier on where I said, actually, we're just mapping the people who are competent to assess resistance, that map over the next few years will become hugely populated with data that just comes from these DNA tests that we're developing. The database fits in alongside a number of other sources of data, like the parasitemia data from the malaria information system designed by WHO, and intervention data so that we can tell what was actually being done in that area. From the database, you create maps or whatever other output it is that the local malaria control campaign wants, so that this guy who was collecting the data in the first place actually gets feedback and knows what to do with the data that arrives there. So we can see here a complete circle of data creation and feedback that empowers the team to work in a more effective way. The databases are quite complicated, and the way we're addressing this is to say, well, what we need is to have a common data spine that all of the databases will have to, so that we're making that commonly available. But the front and back end of the database is specific to each country, because each country wants to have their database look like something they're familiar with. It needs to be addressing issues like local mapping, local language. So what they get is a database that's specific to them, but underlying it is a data structure that then allows one, as they become comfortable with sharing that data, to look at regional and eventually global data systems. These kinds of databases using contemporary mapping technology are capable of fabulous detail about what is really going on in disease outbreaks. And in particular, they give us the opportunity to do very specific epidemiological trials about the outbreak of disease and to use those to test new paradigms and new approaches in vector control. Finally, just to give you a feel for what this whole endeavor in the long term is going to cost, this is the RBM Global Malaria Action Plan costing for what the whole package is going to cost if we're going to get there in the end. And you can see we're looking in the order of $1 billion. So this is not a cheap activity. This is something that is going to be a significant part of the overall drive to eventually eradicate malaria. But we have to find ways in which that can be funded. I think that's everything I wanted to say for the moment. Just to summarize, we have great opportunities coming through in new formulations and new active ingredient screening. We have a series of information systems coming through. There are an enormous number of opportunities around us. There's never been a better time to come into this industry to work on the opportunities that vector control provides, but there's an awful long way to go before we have a solution. So thank you, and I'll take questions later.